We're going to start off here and we're going to look at different ways to do user-defined input or user input and output and all that kind of stuff. This is really, really important because, you know, it's kind of hard to write a program with all the inputs directly in there. You know, like whenever you buy TurboTax, you don't just like start it and it goes, you owe $1,000. You've actually got to put in input and then it gives you output based on that input. So this is a really simple thing to do, but well, yeah, it's a basically simple thing to do. It's just something that you want to get started with. So we're going to start with a couple of different ways to do, well, there's really only one way kind of that we want to do user-defined input, but let's call this input. So it's really not that hard. You just ask the user for what you want by saying input. You say, what, I don't know, what's a good question to ask? How many Hot Pockets did you have for breakfast? So look at the syntax of this. I've got the word input, an open parenthesis, and then the prompt is going to appear in these little apostrophe thingies. So if I go, how many Hot Pockets did you have for breakfast? And I run it, and it's going to ask, and I'll say I had 7 Hot Pockets. All right, good, makes sense. Now there's some things that we can do to make this pretty, because this is what the user's actually going to see. So as ugly and stupid and weird and quirky as your code is, you want your input statements, your output statements, things that the user sees to be very clear. So I'm going to start and make that capital, and then it's going to, let me put a CLC clear at the beginning of my statement just so it clears out every time. All right. How many Hot Pockets did you have for breakfast? 7. Yay. See, now it looks a little bit better. This is kind of funny. See how there's a question mark and then it goes straight to 7? So what I can do is I can come over here and I can actually put in a couple of extra spaces, and then it'll print the spaces before I type the 7, which is just kind of neat. Something that you may have noticed, so this will happen sometimes, the students will say they'll run the section and then they'll be like, oh man, I didn't really want to know Hot Pockets. I wanted to know how many, what else do people have for breakfast? SpaghettiOs. Did you have for breakfast? And then they'll run it and they're like, my code's not working because I changed it to SpaghettiOs, but it still has Hot Pockets. But there's kind of a trick. This is how you know that something's going on. Basically what happens is I asked the user for input, but I never actually gave it input. And then I tried to change it again. Did I spell SpaghettiOs right? I don't think it really matters. But anyway, if you put your little mouse up in the text editor and it spins like that, that means that it's waiting for input from you. That means that we haven't actually finished the last time that we ran the program. This can happen whenever you've got an input statement. It can also happen when you've got like an infinite while loop and stuff like that, which we haven't talked about yet. But anyway, so the way to get out of that is you've got to come back and you have to click back down in your command window. If your command window hasn't turned blue, you haven't clicked in it correctly. And you're going to hit Control C. That's going to break it. Now you see it's asked me for SpaghettiOs because I actually clicked the run section a couple times. So I'm just going to keep clicking Control C until it all clears out. Now I can come up here again and I can run my section. How many SpaghettiOs did you have for breakfast? I had 3 cans. Yay! All right. Something else to keep in mind is whenever you're asking your user for stuff, they don't really need to know where you've stored that variable. So I'm going to suppress the output. Do you remember how to suppress the output? Maybe, kind of. You suppress the output with a semicolon. So if I put in a semicolon, that'll suppress the output. So now when I say, how many SpaghettiOs did you have for breakfast? And I say 9, it's like, cool. All right, so the information is still there. See over there, Z is still equal to 9. It just didn't display it to the user because the user doesn't really care what you call the stupid variable. It just wants to know, I don't know, whether or not they're having a good breakfast, I guess. All right, make sense? Now, I'm gonna go ahead and save this. These are my notes. All right, so I got my notes. Now, try to run your section again, and you might have already done this inadvertently and then not known why it didn't work, but say I had 3 cans, and I type in 3 cans, I get an error. Right? This is important. MATLAB does not like it whenever you mix text and numbers. Well, it can, but then it all has to be text. So we're going to have a little bit of a discussion about this. But basically the idea is, whenever I have a question like, how many SpaghettiOs did you have for breakfast? Something that's put into those little apostrophe thingies, that's a string. Okay, the word I'm saying is a string. String. So a string is like a string of letters. So it's like a string of characters. That's different than like a number. So like if I just wanted to say, I don't really have a good example. I want to say 5 chickens. If I just type that in, it totally freaks out. I get the same kind of error. So whenever I come up here, if I'm going to be expecting user, or there's actually two different ways to do it. So here's one way, is I could say, how many SpaghettiOs did you have for breakfast? I, as the user, could know how MATLAB works, and I could respond with 3 cans, but put it into little apostrophes, okay? So if I put apostrophe, 3 cans, enter, it's totally fine. Now over here in my workspace, you see that it says 3 cans. Something that you may not have noticed, though, let me just make another line that does this exact same thing, except I'm gonna call it Y. How many SpaghettiOs did you have for breakfast? So first of all, I'm gonna say 3, and then I'm gonna say 3 cans. Look over in your workspace. You actually see that you've got two different symbols next to Y and Z. So Y says 3, Z says 3 cans, and it has the little apostrophe thingies on it. If I scroll out enough, it's gonna call it a class as a double, and a double actually indicates how the computer stores the information, but it basically means a number. It's a 1-by-1 number, right? Remember we talked about how MATLAB stores everything in matrices? So even though it's a 3, it's a 1-by-1 matrix. This is a character string. And see how it's got a little ABC on it? That's the indicator that it's a character. It's actually a 1-by-6, but it's just kind of funny because that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 3 with a space and the word cans has 4 characters. So it's actually stored as a 1-by-6. That's kind of above and beyond what you need to know, but whenever I'm programming something, I probably don't want somebody to say 3 cans because, say, I was going to multiply, I don't know how many calories are in a, I don't know, a jar of SpaghettiOs is probably like 320 or something. So I would say Y times 320. I'm going to go ahead and take this guy back out. I'll leave it as C because that's what I had to begin with. All right. So I'll be like, okay, so my calories is Z times 320. And that works, but if the user puts in 3 cans, this is a really weird thing. Okay, don't freak out. Basically, what's happened is MATLAB has gone through and figured out the ASCII code for all of these different letters and then multiplied it by 320. If you just pretend for a minute that a can of SpaghettiOs is 1 calorie, and I put in 3 cans again, so this is way beyond what we need to know right now, but basically, like, the character 3 corresponds to the number 51 in ASCII code, and the space is a 32, and the C is a 99. If you super duper want to know what we're talking about, you can come to here and you can Google ASCII table. So whenever I say ASCII, that's how I spell it, A-S-C-I-I, ASCII table. ASCII table, I like this one. And if I come down to 32, see how 32 is a space, and 3 is a 51. So my number 3, my character 3 is a 51 in on my ASCII chart. So that's why whenever I put in a 3, I get a 51, and my space is a 32. So you'd expect C, A, N, S to be 99, 97, 110, and 115. And in fact, that is what you get. Notice it has to be a lowercase c, because lowercase c is 99, capital C is 67. So anyway, you can get all kinds of crazy stuff if you're not careful. So as a programmer, so that we don't end up with number of calories being some completely nonsensical value, what I could do is I could say enter number of cans, like that. And then that way my user would know, okay, don't actually type in 3 cans. That kind of makes sense. All right, so we've done that. And in case you want to have this word down here, the word I was doing was ASCII. Word there. And letters correspond. Anyway, all right, so that said, you might say, well, sometimes I want to know how many. I want to know, like, string information. So let's go with a string input. So I'm going to tell MATLAB to ask for some specific information. So I'm going to start with a CLC clear, and I'm going to say, I don't know, I'm going to say name, so like it can say input, what's your, name? Now, a bunch of things have gone wrong. very, very quickly. You see I have what's your name? So what's basically happened here is that MATLAB has seen an open character, or a little apostrophe thing, letters, and then a closed apostrophe thing, and it's like, oh, that must be the text you want, in which case, why are you adding all this junk? So the way this is reading right now really tells me that what MATLAB thinks I'm trying to do is have an input that just says what. What? But it doesn't. What I'm really saying is what's your name? So in order to actually display, now I could just say that, what's your name? No worries, and that would work totally fine. That said, another way to actually make it look pretty would be to put a double thingy there, double apostrophe. This is not a quote, so this was not a one thing. In fact, if I do that, it's actually gonna look goofy. So my name is three. But if I come in here and I go a double apostrophe, I'll get what's your name? My name is three. My name isn't really three. My name is Bugaboo. Bugaboo. My name is Bugaboo. And then it gets sad because, you know, that's not a number. And MATLAB only likes numbers. So it's gonna keep asking me. So unless you really want to fix this, well, you can't really fix the code. I could give it a number, but remember what I do. If I come up here and I see that little thingy spinning, that means I need to come back down on my command window and hit Control-C. Okay, so again, hit Control-C to get out of a bad code run. If you get really desperate, you can just exit out of MATLAB altogether, but then you've lost everything since you last saved. Speaking of which, go ahead and save, because it's fun and stuff. All right, so what's your name? Now, I'm gonna run this now. If I wanted, I could spell bugaboo and put it into quotes, but what's the chances that your user actually knows that? So there's an extra character that we can do to the input statement where we put a comma and then S. S stands for string. So S stands for string. So now whenever I run what's your name, I can just type bugaboo and it works. So what that does is that's a little alert to MATLAB that says, hey, my user is going to put in a string, so expect a string and don't freak out. Don't treat this like a number. Kind of makes sense? So the thing you have to be careful about is, say I had the number of cans and I said input how much SpaghettiOs, how much, I don't want to say how much food because I don't want to spell all that again. How much food? And then I did this, so my name is still Bugaboo. And my food is three, but look that over here, cans has been stored as three. So you can't just always use the little S thing and hope it'll work. You really have to do it when you need a string and not do it when you don't need a string. So I'm gonna take that out so I don't confuse myself later. Okay, but the S stands for string. Kind of makes sense? All right, do, 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 do. Beautiful, all right. So that's really the most of what you need to know for string input. The biggest things that are going to get you on here is forgetting like the double parentheses, double apostrophe, not remembering to put the string command on there, and that kind of thing.